children. You all like fairy tales, don't you? Of beautiful princesses and fairies and happy endings. I have here a number of fairy tales specially selected for you. The first story I tell you is about Cinderella. A long, long time ago, there lived a pretty girl called Ella. She was the only child of a rich merchant and his wife, and was dearly loved by both her parents. But when Ella was 14 years old, her mother died, and in order to give Ella a new mother, her father got married again. This new stepmother had two grown-up daughters. But all the three of them were so bad, so horrible, that poor Ella's father also died with grief and worry for his darling daughter Ella. Poor Ella, she was all alone in this world with no one to love her. And now her stepmother and two stepsisters were even worse than before. They were ugly and lazy and jealous of Ella's fair beauty. They soon made a slave out of Ella. She had to work all day long and kept getting beaten up without any reason. And since she always worked near the cinders and got dirty, her stepmother and stepsisters decided to call her Cinderella. They wore beautiful clothes and ate good food from the money she had inherited from her father, and she herself got torn clothes and morsels of leftover food. She did not even have a proper bed and had to sleep in the attic with the rats. One day, the king of that land decided that his son, the prince, should get married. He announced that he would give a great ball and invite all the beautiful ladies of the neighborhood. The prince could choose his bride from amongst them. The heralds of the king went all around the town making this announcement. And there was excitement in every house that had a grown-up daughter. Cinderella's two stepsisters were also very excited. One was fat and ugly, and the other was thin and ugly. But they thought that they were very beautiful, and so did their mother. When Cinderella asked if she could also go to the ball, they all laughed and made fun of her and made her work extra hard in dressing them up and polishing their shoes and tying their ribbons. When they finally left with their mother, quite confident of getting the prince, Cinderella went sadly to the kitchen and, sitting by the fireplace, cried her eyes out. Poor Cinderella. She missed her mother and father's love, and she had no one she could call her own. Suddenly, there was a bright light in the room, and Cinderella looked up in surprise to see a beautiful fairy standing and smiling down at her. "Why are you crying, dear child?" she asked Cinderella affectionately. "I wanted to go to the princess ball with the others, but they did not take me." Now, wipe away your tears," said the fairy. "I am your fairy godmother, and I have come to help you. I will send you to the ball."
"Oh, dear godmother, you are so kind," said Cinderella. "Are you really going to send me to the ball?" "Oh, but I have only these rags, and I won't be allowed to get in."
"Don't worry, my child," said the fairy godmother, comforting her. "Now we have no time to waste. You do as I tell you. Run along and get me a pumpkin from your kitchen garden. I will also need 4 rabbits and 8 mice." Cinderella had no difficulty in getting all these. She was so kind and gentle with all the animals. So they both went out into the garden, and when Cinderella had got the mice from the attic, the pumpkin from the kitchen garden, and her pet rabbits from the pen, the fairy did a magic. She touched the pumpkin with her wand, and it became a golden coach. Then she touched the 4 rabbits, and they
turned into 4 white horses, and the 8 mice became the coachmen and the pages.
Oh, how lovely! Cinderella cried with surprise. And then the fairy godmother touched Cinderella's clothes with her wand, and her old clothes changed into the most beautiful gown she had ever seen in her life. Her lovely golden hair was adorned with pearls, and there were diamonds on her fingers. Cinderella could not believe her eyes. And then the fairy godmother touched her magic wand on Cinderella's feet, and she found herself wearing a pair of delicate glass slippers. "Now listen to me carefully," said the fairy godmother. "You are under a magic spell. You can go to the ball and walk and talk and dance like a princess. But on the stroke of midnight, the spell will end. And so you must return before midnight. Do not forget, my dear." "Oh, dear godmother, how can I ever thank you for what you have done for me?" Cinderella cried with gratitude. "Don't give it another thought. And now, run along to the ball before it is too late," said the fairy, and disappeared into thin air. And so, Cinderella stepped into the grand carriage and rode like a princess to the king's palace. As she regally climbed up the long steps to the main hall, Cinderella felt confident and happy. And as she crossed the marble floors and passed the draped velvet curtains, all eyes turned towards her. She was certainly the most beautiful lady of that evening. The prince at once walked up to her and asked her to dance with him. Her beauty and grace had charmed him, and he danced every single dance with her. Cinderella was absolutely thrilled. She had spotted her 2 stepsisters and her stepmother looking very jealous and angry, but they had not recognized her in her finery. The music played softly. The dancers glided under the glowing lights of the crystal chandeliers, and to Cinderella it seemed like a dream. She was totally lost in it. And suddenly she heard the loud chimes from the clock. Alas, it was striking midnight, and she had forgotten her promise to her fairy godmother. She could not wait a second longer. Holding her gown, she ran down the long staircase as fast as her legs could carry her, and she stepped into the coach just in time. But in her hurry, she had lost one of her glass slippers. The prince ran after her down the stairs, but Cinderella was too fast for him. She had already gone. The poor prince was most upset. He had not even asked her her name, and he had wanted to ask her hand in marriage. As he walked back dejected and sad, he suddenly spotted a glass slipper on the steps and at once recognized it to be that of Cinderella. At last, he had some hope of finding her. He summoned his royal messengers and told them to find the girl whose foot could fit this glass slipper, for that was the girl the prince would marry. In the meanwhile, Cinderella was back in her old rags, making the fire and awaiting the return of her stepmother and stepsisters from the ball. When they did come, they wouldn't stop showing off about the good time that they had had at the ball. "Oh, that prince was so handsome," exclaimed the fat and ugly one. "He danced with me 4 times. I think he will choose me to be his bride." "What utter nonsense," exclaimed the thin and ugly one. "I think he took a fancy to me. I shall be the bride. You just wait and see." Now, never mind which one of you he marries," cut in their mother. "Whoever it is, we all shall go and live in the palace."
Cinderella heard them talking in this manner. She turned away and smiled to herself, for she knew what the truth was. She thought about the handsome and good-natured prince. She knew he would never know who she was, and nor could she ever dream of marrying him. But she was content to have at least met him. The next day, there was a lot of noise and activity down their street. The king's messengers had arrived, and they were going from house to house, making the damsels try out the glass slipper. And each girl was hoping that the slipper would fit them. So far, the slipper had not fitted any of them. When they reached Cinderella's house, the two stepsisters rushed out and one by one impatiently thrust each foot into their glass slipper.
"Oh, it won't fit you! Your feet are too thin and long," said the fat, ugly sister. "Oh, be quiet! Your feet are fat and round. They'll never be able to squeeze into the delicate sandal," said the thin, ugly sister.
Alas, none of their feet fitted the sandal. The messengers were just leaving when suddenly one of them spotted Cinderella sweeping the yard. He called her to try on the slipper, and the two stepsisters tried to send her off. But the messenger insisted that Cinderella should try on the slipper. So Cinderella put her feet into the slipper, and to everyone's shock, the little glass slipper fitted her perfectly. Just then, there was a bright light, and the fairy godmother descended amidst them. She touched Cinderella with her wand, and in a flash, she was transformed, wearing the beautiful gown and jewelry, looking even more lovelier than the day at the prince's ball. Cinderella's stepmother fainted with shock, and her stepsisters fell on their knees and asked her for their forgiveness. They even begged Cinderella to take them with her to the king's palace. The prince was overjoyed to know that the beautiful girl was found, and soon there was a grand wedding at the royal palace. Cinderella forgave her stepmother and stepsisters, and she and her prince lived happily ever after. The next story I tell you is about the real princess. There was once a prince who wished to get married, but he wanted to marry a real princess. He tried at many different places in different parts of the world to find a real princess, but he could not make up his mind whether they were real or not, because something or the other was always lacking in them. After traveling for many months, he returned back to his kingdom quite sad, because he had so much wanted to have a real princess for his wife, but had been unable to find one. One night, there was a huge storm accompanied by thunder and lightning. Rain came lashing down, and there was no moonlight. It was pitch dark. Suddenly, there was a violent knocking at the main door of the palace. The old king, the father of the prince, himself went to open the door. As he opened the door, a young lady stood there, cold and shivering. The water trickled from her hair, and her wet clothes clung to her body, making her look quite miserable.
"Please, Your Majesty, can you give me shelter for the night? I am a princess and have got lost in the rain."
The king would not believe that she was a princess and said so.
"But Your Highness, I assure you, I am a real princess."
The queen mother overheard their conversation and, feeling sorry for the cold and wet girl, called her inside and said,
"We shall see about that later. Come in or you will catch a chill."
She gave the girl a change of dry clothes and some hot food and went to get a bed prepared for her. However, she gave no hint of what she was going to do. She went quietly into the bedroom, took off all the beddings off the bed and put three little peas on the bedstead. She then called the maids and made them put 20 mattresses and 20 feather beds over the mattresses. The princess came in just then
and she was comfortably tucked into bed. The next morning, the Queen Mother came in with a glass of hot milk and gently asked the princess how she had slept.
"Oh, Queen Mother," the princess wailed, "I could hardly sleep. I do not know what was in my bed, but it seemed to be something hard. The whole night I have done nothing but toss and turn, and my back is quite sore."
The Queen Mother was now quite convinced that this was a real princess, since she had been able to feel the three little peas through all the 20 mattresses and 20 feather beds. None but a real princess could have such a delicate sense of feeling. And thus, having found a real princess, the prince got married to her, and they lived happily for many years to come. The next story I tell you is about the singing nightingale. The Emperor of China had one of the most beautiful palaces in the world, and his large gardens with a beautiful variety of flowers drew many visitors from far-off lands. Whoever walked to the far end of the garden came across a wood with very high trees, and beyond the trees was the sea. Amongst the branches of these tall trees lived a nightingale who sang so sweetly that even the fishermen who came to the shore at night to cast their nets stood still to listen to her song. The travelers who came from different parts of the world talked about the grand palace, the gardens, the beautiful city, but whoever heard the nightingale said that that was the best of all. Many poets also wrote about the emperor's kingdom and the nightingale that sang in the woods near the sea, and after many months, one of these books reached the emperor. He felt very pleased when he read about the wonderful descriptions of his kingdom, but got stuck when he read, "But the nightingale is the best of all." He was surprised and angry. "What is this nightingale that I am reading about? How can there be such a bird in my own garden without my having ever heard of it?" He called his prime minister and asked him, "Where is this remarkable nightingale whose song is worth more than anything else in my kingdom? Why have I not been told about her?" "I myself have never heard of her," said the prime minister. "I wish her to come and sing for me this evening. Go and find her. The whole world seems to know what I have but myself." The emperor was in a rage. His word was a command, and the prime minister knew that he must find the nightingale at once, or else he would lose his position at court. He wasted no time. He ran through all the halls of the palace, asking whoever he came across if they had seen or heard the nightingale about whom the whole world talked, but no one seemed to know of her. Just then, someone came and said that a maid in the kitchen knew and had heard the beautiful nightingale in the woods on the outskirts of the palace. The prime minister called her at once, and she repeated what he wanted to hear.
"Yes, your majesty. When I go every evening with some leftover food for my sick mother, I hear the nightingale sing, and it makes tears come to my eyes."
"Will you take me to the nightingale just now?" the prime minister asked her. "You find me the nightingale, and I will make you the chief maid of the kitchen." And they, along with some courtiers, went together to the woods where the nightingale sang. Now none of them had heard the voice of a nightingale. Just then they heard a cow mooing. They got excited and began running in that direction. The kitchen maid exclaimed, "Stop, stop! Those are cows that you hear mooing. We are still far from where the nightingale sings." After some time, they heard some frogs croaking in a pond, and again the kitchen maid stopped them. Just then, they heard the most beautiful sound coming from amidst the trees.
"Listen to her," cried the kitchen maid. "There she is, the nightingale, high up on that branch. Just listen to her."
All of them heard the nightingale sing with her melodious voice. They could not believe that a bird could produce such beautiful tunes.
"How simple she looks," exclaimed the Prime Minister.
"And her voice sounds like the tinkling of glass bells. But will she come to the court this evening?" He suddenly remembered the Emperor's command. Just then, the nightingale spoke out.
"Does the Emperor want to hear me sing?"
The Prime Minister at once replied,
"Yes, dear Nightingale, I would be very grateful to you if you could come to the court festival this evening. The Emperor wishes to hear you sing. Will you come?"
"The Emperor's wish? And me not come? Of course I will be there. Though I do feel my song will sound much better here among the trees."
"Let the Emperor himself decide that," said the Prime Minister, and the Nightingale followed them to the palace. The Emperor came in all his royal splendor to hear the Nightingale sing. A lot of courtiers and distinguished guests awaited to hear the Nightingale, for whom a golden perch had been fixed. Even the kitchen maid, who had been given the title of Chief Maid of the Kitchen, had permission to stand behind the Prime Minister. When all were ready, the Emperor signaled and the Nightingale was summoned. She began to sing. She sang so sweetly that very soon tears came to the Emperor's eyes and rolled down his cheeks. And when she sang more, the Emperor was even more pleased and gave her the title of the Imperial Court Singer. But the Nightingale said, "I have seen tears in the Emperor's eyes. That is a bigger reward for me." All the ladies in the court, all the gentlemen, all the footmen, all the maids had only one topic to discuss: the beautiful voice of the Nightingale. The people in the city also talked about her, and some of them even named their children after her. The Nightingale became the chief guest of the Emperor, and a golden cage was built for her. She was allowed to fly out twice during the day and once during the night, and she had 6 people specially allotted to attend to her. Every evening, the Emperor would summon her and ask her to sing, and she would sing different tunes every day, keeping in mind the Emperor's own mood. One day, the Emperor received a gift. He thought that it was another big book describing the power and beauty of the Nightingale's voice. But when the parcel was opened, it contained a bird that looked just like this Nightingale. But it was a mechanical bird and decorated with rubies and diamonds and pearls. When the artificial Nightingale was wound up, it sang a beautiful tune. And while it sang, its tail, all glittered with silver and gold, went up and down all the time, and its head went from side to side. All those present in the court were very pleased to see and hear this beautiful-looking artificial bird. The Emperor also could not take his eyes off her. He heard her sing the same tune for more than 25 times, and then he desired to hear the real Nightingale. But where was she? She had flown off from her cage deep into the green woods. The Emperor flew into a rage, and the courtiers declared that she was an ungrateful bird. The Emperor banished her from his court, and the artificial bird was given the title of High Imperial Court Singer.
and was even placed by the emperor's bedside when he slept. The bird sang the same tune every day, and the emperor, the courtiers, and even the little children in the streets all knew the song of the artificial bird. The emperor ordered volumes to be written about this bird, and when people far and wide read about it, they came to hear it sing. But one day, while the emperor lay in bed listening to the artificial bird, there was a sudden whirring sound, and a spring inside the bird cracked. The wheels stopped moving, and the music also stopped. The emperor was most upset. The best clockmakers were called from all over the empire to repair the mechanical bird and set it right, but none of them succeeded. The emperor offered large rewards to whoever could set the bird right, but no one who tried succeeded. The emperor coaxed the bird to sing by giving him more diamonds and rubies to wear, but still it would not sing. He just could not get him out of his mind, and he soon fell ill. As days went by and the mechanical bird still did not sing, the emperor's condition became worse. The court's doctors said that they also would not be able to keep him alive much longer. Everybody in the kingdom was worried and sad. Then one morning, the little kitchen maid, who was now the head maid in the kitchen, said, "Why can't we call the real nightingale to sing for the emperor? Perhaps her singing might help to make his majesty better." The prime minister wasted no time. He sent her to beg the real nightingale to come and sing for the emperor. The real nightingale was merrily singing away high up in the branches, and when the maid requested her to come and sing for the emperor, who she said was very ill, the nightingale replied, "Of course I will come. How can I not sing for the emperor who has given me so much comfort in the past?" And she flew to the emperor's window and sang the most beautiful notes one could ever hear. The prime minister stood by, and so did the chief courtiers, praying that the emperor recovers after hearing the voice of the nightingale. And as the sound of the nightingale floated to the emperor's ears, he slowly opened his eyes and moved a little. There was a weak smile on his face, and tears began rolling down his eyes. He called the nightingale to his side and softly and lovingly spoke to her. "I cannot thank you enough. I have been blinded by the artificial nightingale and had banished you from my palace, but you have helped me recover. Will you forgive me and stay with me for always? You will sing only when it pleases you, and I will break the artificial bird into shreds." The nightingale promised the emperor that she would never leave him and sing for him always. She needed no rewards, and her biggest reward was to see happiness on the emperor's face. And once again, the emperor of China and his nightingale's name spread far and wide across the world, and many more books were written in praise of the nightingale's golden voice. The next story I tell you is about the good girl and the bad girl. There was once a widow who had two daughters. The elder girl was the apple of her mother's eye, and she was given the best possible clothes to wear and good food to eat, and was spoilt and pampered. She was not given any work, and she relaxed all day long, feeling quite pleased with life. But the younger girl was not her mother's favorite. From the time she remembers, her mother had never been kind to her. She had given her old rags to wear, and for food she got only the leftover morsels. She had to work all day long, sweeping the floor, cooking, washing, stitching, and late at night she would crawl into bed, weary and tired. This was the time she cried herself to sleep, wondering why she received no kindness from her mother and sister, though she was always good to them. One day, the good daughter was sent into the forest to pick wild strawberries. And as she wandered about from one bush to another, she suddenly realized that she had lost her way. She ran in all directions, but just could not find her way home. Evening fell, and she was cold and frightened. She sat on a rock and began to cry. And she spilled the whole basket of strawberries all over the ground. Just then, she heard a sound nearby. She turned to see, and to her surprise saw an old woman standing there. She was dressed in black and had long white flowing hair that almost touched the ground. She came near and asked, "Why are you crying, dear child?" The girl told her between sobs, "I have lost my way home, and now, even if I find it, I am afraid to go home because I have dropped all these strawberries, and my mother and sister will beat me and drive me out." "If you are afraid of your mother, come and serve me. You will be happy with me," said the old woman. The miserable girl thought that it was better to go with this old woman than face the beating at home. And so they both wandered through the wood till they reached a stream. "Please carry me to the other side of the stream," the old woman said. "I am old and frail, and I am afraid that the gushing water will sweep me away." "Of course I will," the girl agreed willingly, though she was worried whether she could carry the weight of the old woman. But she proved to be as light as a bird, and they crossed the stream safely. On walking a little further, they reached a small cottage, which was where the old woman lived. There was no one else in the cottage except for two dogs and two cats. "I want you to look after my house and my two dogs and two cats. If you work well, you will be rewarded," the old woman told the girl. She was a strange old woman, for she talked to her dogs and cats as though they were human beings, and they in turn answered her in human voices. If she needed them for any work, she would ring a small bell and say, "You dogs, sweep the floor, and you cats, open the windows and give me my stick." But the girl jumped up and did all the work given to the animals. She not only did the housework, but looked after the dogs and the cats with the same gentleness as the old woman. She gave them a bath, brushed their furry coats, took out thorns from their paws, and even played games with them. When it was time to have dinner, the old woman called the girl and told her, "Here, take this pea and this grain of rice and cook us some food. And later, divide it equally between all the six of us." The girl shook her head with wonder and could not imagine how these two little grains would feed all of them. But she said nothing, and putting the pot on the fire, poured in some water and put these two grains also into it. And she saw such a strange sight that she wondered whether the pot was magical or the two grains. For in a little while, the contents of the pot began to bubble and a delicious smell filled the room, and there was food for a whole army. And then she divided it fairly and equally amongst all of them, and the old woman thanked her warmly for being such a willing worker. This went on for weeks and months till a whole year of service was complete. The old woman called the girl to her side and said, "You have served me well. Even my dogs and my cats were well looked after. I shall reward you well. Tomorrow morning, when you wake up, you go to the room at the back of my cottage. In that room, there are many boxes of different kinds. You choose any one of them and go home. But remember, only open it when you reach home." The girl thanked her and went to bed. The animals also went up to her and thanked her. One of the cats said, You have been very kind to us. You deserve the best present. The next morning, when the girl woke up, she remembered what the old woman had told her, and she went to the room at the back of the cottage. The animals also followed her in, and there she found boxes of all sizes and patterns. Some were simple and some had gold edges, some were inlaid and some were finely carved. "Why don't you take that one with the gold edge?" the dog said. "Why don't you take the one with the beautiful painting on it?" said a cat. They wanted her to have the best. "My dear pets, I shall be satisfied with a simple one," she said, and stroked them lovingly. She then took a small, simple-looking box and went to the old woman to bid her farewell. When the old woman saw the simple box the girl had chosen, she smiled and said, "You have chosen well, my girl. You shall find happiness always. And yes, you will find it difficult to carry your box all the way home. Just wait." And saying this, she harnessed the box to the two dogs and the two cats and then seated the girl on the box and saw them off. The girl waved goodbye as they drove off, feeling a little sad to leave the old woman. They had a lovely journey with all the squirrels and rabbits in the forest running along with them for company. And as they came nearer her home, people rushed out of their houses and followed them. The old mother and the wicked elder girl had thought that the younger girl had got lost and been eaten up by wolves, and so were very surprised to see her arrive in this strange manner. They did not cry for her, nor did they miss her. But when they saw her unfastening the box, they rushed forward to see what she had brought along in that. And when the younger girl finally opened the box, it was filled with gold and diamonds and rubies. The old mother and her daughter thrust their hand to grab all the wealth, but just then a handsome young prince jumped out of the box and grabbed the young girl. "You must be the girl to be my wife. There is no one else on earth for me but you." And closing the box, he led the young girl out to take her to his palace. The old mother and the wicked sister were shocked, but before they left, they asked the girl where she had been the whole year. And she replied, "Oh, I was in the forest." And she told them briefly how she had spent the year in the company of the old woman. And then waving goodbye to all the well-wishers of the village, she went with the prince for the palace where she would live happily ever after. But the story does not end here. The old mother quickly persuaded her favorite elder daughter also to go into the forest to pick wild strawberries. Being a lazy girl, she took some time to go, but one day she finally went. Once in the forest, she picked up a few strawberries and then sat on the grass and began to cry. She screamed and wailed so loudly that all the forest animals ran away. And just as for the younger girl, the old woman in a black dress and flowing long hair appeared again. On seeing her, the girl commanded, "Take me in your service at once." The old woman agreed at once and they walked through the forest towards her cottage. And on the way, they came across the stream, and the old woman requested the girl to carry her across the stream on her back. "What?" snapped the rude girl. "Are you out of your mind? Why should I drown on account of you?" And she waded across the stream without giving her a second glance. The old woman only smiled and waded through the water quite easily. At the cottage, when the old woman gave her a pea and a grain of rice and asked her to cook, she laughed aloud and went to the kitchen and found the groceries and cooked a large meal, of which she ate a large helping and gave just the little leftovers to the old woman and her animals. She never swept the floor, saying she was too tired, and she also never cared or looked after the dogs and the cats. Soon the poor animals were thin, thorns and dirt sticking to their coats. This continued for days and weeks and months, till a year was complete. And when the old woman asked her to select a box as a reward for her services, the greedy girl chose the most beautiful one, rimmed with gold and inlaid with jewels. The old lady only smiled and harnessed the beautiful box to the animals and set the proud girl on it. The journey was one of the most cruelest journeys the poor animals had been through. For the horrid girl whipped so hard that their fur flew off their backs, and all the animals of the forest also ran away and hid in case she decided to lash them also. When she reached home, the mother and the greedy daughter quickly opened the box. And what do you think they found inside the box? Curled up most comfortably inside was an ugly old snake, who, on seeing the two of them, reared up and coiled himself around the wicked girl and said, "Aha! You are the one for me. There is no one else in this wide world for me." The old woman fainted, and the snake carried off the girl, and she was never to be seen again. The next story is Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. Many, many years ago, in a faraway land, there lived a beautiful princess named Snow White. The king and the queen loved their little daughter very much, and so did all the courtiers in the palace. She was such a lovable child. But alas, once the dear queen fell ill and died. The king was most unhappy, especially so because his daughter would miss his mother. And so, to get her a new mother, he got married again. Now the new queen's face was beautiful, but her heart was black with evil and her eyes were green with jealousy. And she was most jealous of Snow White, because the king loved her very much, and so did all the people of the palace, because she was so kind and gentle with them. The horrid queen began making her wear dull clothes to hide her beauty and gave her a lot of tiring work to do. But no matter what the queen did, Snow White remained as lovely and good-natured as ever. This new queen had a very special mirror in her room. Actually, it was a magic mirror and could talk. For when the queen would stand in front of it and ask, "Mirror, mirror on the wall, who is the fairest one of all?" the mirror would always answer that the queen was the most beautiful lady in the kingdom. Every day, the queen would go to the mirror and ask the same question, and the mirror would give the same answer, and the queen would feel most pleased. But one day, in answer to the question, the mirror replied, "You are fair, my queen, it's true, but Snow White now is lovelier than you." When the queen heard this, she went mad with rage. She threw things around the room and tore up the curtains with her bare hands. "How dare the mirror say such a thing? I will destroy that silly girl, Snow White," she said to herself. And she paced up and down her room, thinking up a wicked plan. And then she shouted out to her maid, who came hurriedly and stood trembling before the queen, who she knew was in a real temper. "Go at once and call the royal huntsman. I want him here now, and not a soul must know about it." The frightened maid ran off to do as she was told. In a short while, the royal huntsman stood before the queen. "I order you to take Snow White into the jungle on the pretext of showing her different animals, and there you shall kill her." The huntsman was shocked to hear this and begged the queen to spare him this awful task. The queen was even more furious. "Go and do as I command, or by tomorrow morning your head shall be cut off." The poor huntsman went away sadly in search of dear Princess Snow White. He led her to the jungle, and as he listened to her happy laughter as she watched the little animals of the forest, he did not have the heart to kill her. Then he slowly told Snow White what the queen had ordered him to do. And he told her to run away into the forest and never come back to the palace, for she was a wicked queen and would not be at peace till she saw Snow White dead. He walked away and killed a deer and took its heart to the queen so that he could fool her into believing that Snow White was dead at last. But Snow White was far from dead. She wandered about the forest and played with the animals and birds and enjoyed herself. But when it began to get dark and she heard strange noises of hungry wild animals, she became very frightened. She did not even know where she was going and often stumbled and fell down. She began to cry and did not know where she would eat or sleep that night. Just then, she noticed a little path through the trees and she decided to walk along it. After a short distance, she came to a clearing and there, right in front of her, was a little cottage. She ran forward quickly and knocked at the door, and when no one answered for a while, she turned the handle and went in. And what a sight she saw! The whole place was in such a mess. The dirty floor, clothes lying all over the place, and in the kitchen, the sink was full of used vessels. The other end of the room, she saw 7 tiny beds. She was so tired that she wanted to sleep at once, but she decided to clean up the place. So she quickly swept the floor, folded and put away the clothes, and cleaned up the used vessels in the kitchen. And then she fell flat on one of the 7 beds and fell asleep almost at once. This cottage actually belonged to 7 little dwarfs who worked in the diamond mines, and in a little while they all returned to their home whistling a merry tune. When on opening the door they saw their untidily left room looking so spick and span, they could not believe their eyes. But they received a further shock when they saw the fair and beautiful maiden sleeping on one of their beds. Snow White woke up when she heard noises, but when she saw these 7 little men all staring at her, she was not afraid of them because they all looked so kind. "Who are you, fair maiden?" asked the eldest dwarf. "I am a princess and my name is Snow White," she replied, and between tears she narrated her sad story. All the 7 dwarfs felt sorry for her and cried along with her. And when her story ended, the eldest dwarf begged her to stay with them and keep house for them. Snow White was very pleased to hear this and readily accepted. And from that day onwards, Snow White lived very happily with the 7 dwarfs and cooked for them and sewed their clothes and sang with them, and she even taught them to be cleaner people. And when each morning they went to the diamond mine to work, they always asked her to lock the door of the cottage and warned her never to let anyone into the cottage while they were away. Meanwhile, at the palace, the queen was most pleased to have got rid of her stepdaughter. She was once again the most beautiful woman in the kingdom. But one day, when she asked her magic mirror who was the fairest of all, the mirror replied, "O queen, you are fairest of all, I see. But deep in the forest where the 7 dwarfs dwell, Snow White is alive and well, and no one is as fair as she." On hearing this, the queen flew into a violent rage. "So I have been tricked by the huntsman. This time I shall do the job myself. I shall not entrust it to anyone." She wasted no time. Disguising herself as an old woman, she set off for the forest. In her hand, she carried a basket full of the most rosiest looking and sweetest of apples you have ever seen. When she reached the cottage of the 7 dwarfs, she knocked on the door. But remembering the warning of the dwarfs, Snow White did not open the door, but looked out of the window to see who it was. She saw an old woman who looked ill and tired, and when she saw Snow White, she cried out for help. Snow White forgot all about the warning and immediately opened the door to let her in and gently helped her on the couch to rest. When the old woman had recovered, she took the juiciest looking apple from her basket and gave it to Snow White. "Eat it, my dear. It is just a small token of my gratitude." But as soon as Snow White had had a bite, she fell on the floor as though in a deep sleep. The wicked queen quickly ran back to the palace, quite pleased at having got rid of Snow White. And when the seven dwarfs came home from work in the evening, they were shocked to find Snow White lying on the floor. They tried all kinds of treatments to wake her up, but nothing helped. They all cried for the loss of their dear princess. But though she did not move, they did not want her out of their sight. And so they built a beautiful coffin of glass and laid her in it. And then they carried the coffin deeper into the forest and put it down near a glade of flowers. For days and nights they sat around it, hoping that she might just wake up. And all the small animals and birds of the forest to whom she had been kind also came and sat around the coffin. One day, a prince who was on a hunt in the forest happened to ride by, and on seeing the dwarf sitting sadly around the coffin, he got off his horse. On coming nearer, he saw Snow White and could not believe his eyes, for she was the most beautiful maiden he had ever seen in his life. He asked the dwarfs how they were related to her, and they told him her sad story. The prince had fallen in love with Snow White, and he begged the dwarfs to let him take the coffin back to his palace so that she would always be close to him. The dwarfs refused at once, for they also loved Snow White dearly. But when they saw the prince coming to the glade every day and just stand and stare at Snow White with sad eyes, they felt sorry for him and finally agreed to let him take the coffin to his palace. The prince thanked them sincerely and made quick arrangements for a carriage to carry the coffin. When the dwarfs were carrying the coffin, one of them stumbled, and with the jolt, the piece of apple in Snow White's throat got dislodged. The poison gone, Snow White awoke as though from a long, long sleep. All the dwarfs danced around Snow White with happiness, and the birds chirped with joy, and the animals also joined in the rejoicing. The prince asked Snow White if she would marry him, and she replied shyly, "I would like to take my father's permission." The prince and Snow White and the seven dwarfs all set off to the palace of Snow White's father, and when he saw his dear daughter, whom he believed was dead, tears of happiness rolled down his eyes. The horrid queen was banished from the kingdom, and a grand wedding took place. Snow White and her prince lived happily and were often visited by the seven dwarfs and the other little animal friends of the forest. And this last story that I tell you is about the dewdrop crown. In one of the smaller kingdoms of China, there lived an emperor who had a very beautiful daughter. Tales of her beauty had spread far and wide, but it was also mentioned that she was also very proud of her beauty. She was thoroughly spoilt by the love of her father, and was rude and mean to many of her maids and courtiers. She wore only the best of clothes, robes of brocade and satin and silk, and they were embroidered with precious jewels. The king ordered jewelers from all over the world to bring her the best made jewelry. And yet, the proud princess was never satisfied with what she had. One night, not being able to sleep, the princess ran from her room and wandered around through the gardens till daybreak, when the sun slowly peeped from behind the horizon and rose higher into the sky. Its beams shone on every dewdrop spread all across the grass, leaves and flowers. Never before had the princess seen such a beautiful sight. The sparkle of the dewdrops had taken her breath away. The birds chirped merrily to welcome the happy day, and the princess ran all the way home to wake up her father. "Father, father, I have seen the most magnificent sight anyone could ever see," and she told him of her encounter with the breaking of morn. I must have a crown made of dewdrops, or I shall die with longing. The old emperor could not refuse anything his spoiled daughter wished for. So he at once called all the jewelers of his kingdom and commanded them to make a crown as wished by the princess. And if they did not deliver it by morning, their heads would be chopped off. They knew it was an impossible task, and when morning came, they all walked to the king empty-handed and their heads hung low. The vain princess was furious that not one of them could fulfill her wish. Have mercy on us, they all begged. We cannot make such a jewel with our hands. The princess sulked angrily, and the emperor was about to order their heads to be chopped off when an old man with a white beard slowly walked in and said in a very shaky voice, I shall make for your daughter what she is very keen to have, but she must herself pick the finest dewdrops. Then she can have a crown of her own choice. The princess readily agreed and early next morning ran into the garden to collect the biggest and shiniest of dewdrops. But to her amazement, as soon as she touched them, they melted in her hands and the shine disappeared. She went all over the garden at different spots and tried in vain to catch even one dewdrop, but her hand remained empty. In the end, she sat down on the grass, tired and angry with herself, and began to cry. The old man suddenly appeared and, slowly walking up to her, asked her, Hurry up and collect the dewdrops, princess. I would like to start work on the crown. Just collect a handful and I will make a crown even the fairies would envy. I cannot pick any dewdrops. They just dissolve the moment I touch them, she complained. The old man was suddenly angry with her. Go and tell your father to cut off your head first, because you have not managed to fulfill even a part of the work you have given the others, and you want them beheaded. The princess turned red with shame, and she could not look up. She begged for forgiveness and told her father, I do not want the dewdrop crown. It was very foolish of me to ask for it. And the jewelers were sent home with gifts from the princess, and from that day onwards, she was never a proud girl.